Friends, will you please rise in body or spirit? We gather here today to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Carolyn Jean Officer, and we witness to her faith as we come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. We pray that God may grant us comfort, and that in pain we will feel the grace of God around us, and that in sorrow we will be filled with hope, and in death we will experience resurrection, trusting that dying, Christ destroyed our death, and rising, Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism Carolyn put on Christ, so in Christ may Carolyn be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is, and those who have this hope in Christ purify themselves as Christ is pure. For Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." He said, "I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last." He said, "I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also," he says. Won't you join your heart with mine in a moment of prayer? O God, who gave us birth, you are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask. Give to us now your grace, that as we shrink before the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die, and when our days here are accomplished, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that in our living or dying, our life may be in you, as we remember that nothing in life or death will be able to separate us from your great love in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. I invite you now to rise in body or spirit as we sing together, "Great is Thy Faithfulness."
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. As thou hast been, thou for. stars in their courses above. Join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness.
To join your voices with mine in this psalm of hope and promise, the 23rd psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. At this time, I would invite Sarah Daniel to come up, and she's going to read for us a special poem.
Footprints by Mary Stevenson. One night I had a dream. I dreamed I was walking along the beach with the Lord, and across the sky flashed scenes from my life. For each scene, I noticed two sets of footprints. One belonged to me, and the other to the Lord. When the last scene of my life flashed before me, I looked back at the footprints in the sand. I noticed that many times along the path of my life, there was only one set of footprints. I also noticed that it happened at the very lowest and saddest times of my life. This really bothered me, and I questioned the Lord about it. Lord, you said that once I decided to follow you, you would walk with me all the way. But I have noticed that during the most troublesome times in my life, there is only one set of footprints. I don't understand why in times when I needed you most that you should leave me. The Lord replied, my precious, precious child, I love you and I would never, never leave you. During your times of trial and suffering, when you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you.
Good afternoon. Thank you for being here, and for those who have joined us online, thank you for joining in this time together to celebrate the life of my mother, Carolyn. My mom was born on May 12, 1931, to Vernal and Goldie Herman. Goldie was the adopted daughter of Reverend Lucius and Mary Huckins. Reverend Huckins was a circuit rider preacher in Southwest Washington starting in the 1890s and was a prominent figure in the history of Salmon Creek Church. Goldie Huckins married Vernal Herman on November 1st, 1928. It was his third marriage and he had two children from a prior marriage. My mom grew up as a fiercely independent only child. Since her half-brother and half-sister were in their late teens, early 20s, when she was born. My grandmother Goldie became the Sunday school superintendent, music director, and organist for Salmon Creek Church, and Vivi, as he was called, was a businessman, an inventor, and a Salmon Creek Church trustee. On November 1st, 1955, my grandparents were making their way home from their first vacation in many years, visiting family back east. November 1st was also their 27th wedding anniversary. Their airplane, United Flight 629, made a brief stop in Denver for fuel and to pick up additional passengers. A few minutes after the plane took off from Denver, it exploded in midair. The son of one of the new passengers that boarded in Denver had placed a bomb in his mother's luggage in hopes of collecting her life insurance policy. This was the first act of domestic terrorism in the United States and drew national and international attention. A book was even written from the notes of the FBI investigation. My mom was 24 years old, and she and my dad had two young children. My oldest sister Louise was two. My sister Susan was not quite a year old. I still can't grasp what it must have been like for my mom. I was born in October of 1956. My sisters and I grew up not knowing the story behind our grandfather's death. No one ever talked about it. We never thought about why we received so much more love and care from the people of Salmon Creek Church than our friends did. I was probably 10 years old when my sisters and I learned of the details of the death of my grandparents. This was not the only tragedy that my mom experienced in her lifetime. In 1979, my sister Louise called me to tell me that my parents had returned home from their usual Saturday night of moonlight bowling and had found my sister Susan on their couch. She had died while they were out bowling. In the days that followed, we found out that she had an extremely rare lung disease that no one had known about. As a family, we were devastated. Susan was 24 years old. In 2008, my dad, Chuck Officer, passed away after a three-year battle with prostate cancer. The Stephen Ministry from Salmon Creek Church was of great support to my dad. I remember in October of 2012, my brother-in-law Danny calling me on a Sunday afternoon to let me know that my sister Louise had been admitted to the hospital with extreme abdominal pain. Her doctors explained to us that she had stage 4 colon cancer. It was spreading quickly, and there was nothing they could do for her. On the following Wednesday morning, my sister peacefully slipped away into the hands of Jesus. Since 2012, it has just been my mom and me. I was all she had left. In 2020, my mom fell and broke her hip, and was also the time that she was diagnosed with dementia. As a result, she was no longer permitted to drive. She made the decision that it was time to move close to me. In June of 2021, we moved her out of her condo and into the Village Green Retirement Community about 5 minutes from our house in Federal Way. We quickly got into a routine and I visit her 2 to 3 times each week. Over these past couple of years, I learned a lot about my mom's obsession with Hershey's chocolate kisses and ice cream. Although she pretty much forgot everything else about her life, I was very blessed that my mom never forgot who I was, nor did she forget my wife, Kathy, nor any of her 4 grandkids. You're probably wondering why I went into the details about these tragic circumstances in the life of my mom. I have 2 reasons. First, to thank the people of Salmon Creek Church for their loving care of my mom through each of these tragic seasons of her life. She was an unbelievably strong person, and the love and care from the people at this church helped her to grieve and to move forward with her life. Secondly, I want to remind everyone here that none of us knows what tomorrow will bring. James 4:14 says, "Why, you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes." Today is a day of celebration of the life of my mother and for me to recognize those of my family who left before her. She knew Jesus as her Lord and Savior, and I know she is in the presence of Jesus. My dad, two sisters, her parents, and her grandparents, and so many others of our extended family. During this time of grieving, we are also very open to listen to God's small voice. A week after my sister Susan died in 1979, I remember kneeling during her graveside service and crying out to God that I was tired of running from him. And I surrendered my life to him and chose to accept his free gift of salvation. From that moment on, God took what was once my ordinary life and turned it into something special and with a purpose, just to please him and to acknowledge him in everything I do. Accepting the free gift of salvation from Jesus is as simple as ABC. A is for admit what you have done wrong and ask for forgiveness. B is believe that Jesus died on the cross and rose again as a payment for your sins. C is confess and allow God to be in charge of your life. If you have never done this before, I ask that you consider it now. Like my mother, Goldie, my mom attended Salmon Creek Elementary School. My mom graduated from Vancouver High School in 1948 and went to work at a bank in Vancouver. My mom was very smart and a very hard worker. In 1964, she went to work for Container Corporation of America at their plant in St. John's, Oregon. Throughout her 31-year career, she was consistently recognized as the top performer in their accounting department. The pinnacle of her career was when she was promoted to the executive role of controller. She was the first woman at Container to be promoted to controller and the first promoted to controller without having any college education. She was amazing. After her retirement, my mom used her financial management skills and experience to serve as the financial secretary of Salmon Creek Church for over 30 years. After her retirement, every so often she would think back about her career and say to me, "Your mom didn't do too bad for someone with just a high school education." "Yeah, Mom, not bad. You earned it." There are so many areas of her life that I could tell you about. She was the top woman bowler in the greater Portland area and had so many trophies from all those years. There were a lot of bowling trophies. A lot of bowling trophies. She asked me once what I was going to do with all of them. I told her I only wanted one. I just wanted the one that she was the proudest of. It was the trophy she earned in 1970 for having the top women's average in the Portland Traveling All-Star League. This was the premier bowling league in the area, and she averaged 183. She loved gardening, and as my dad would say when I called, "Oh, she's out playing in the dirt." She had a greenhouse in her backyard. She loved spending endless hours each year growing beautiful flowers. We brought some pictures of her beautiful garden for you to see. She enjoyed opening up her home to host gatherings with the people she went to elementary school and high school with. Family reunions were awesome. A few of my cousins here, thank you for coming. Labor Day weekend was special, as the extended officer family would gather at our house from all across the state and as far away as California. Great times, great memories. Lastly, at an early age, my mom became known throughout the area for her outstanding soprano voice and was featured in several musical theater performances, select concert choirs, asked to sing at weddings and funerals, and of course, was a featured soloist for the choir of Salmon Creek Church. She was a first soprano and owned the high notes you usually hear from a single voice in every choir performance. Mom's natural vocal abilities were passed on to me. I was invited to sing in the church's adult choir with her. When I was in middle school, it was such a privilege to sing with my mom growing up. We sang together during the weekly worship services, special music during Christmas, and all the Easter cantatas until I graduated from high school. The tenor section usually sits right behind the sopranos. My mom was always directly in front of me. Fortunately for me, I was a very quick learner of music, because my mom would know immediately if I was singing the wrong notes. Over these many years, my mom got to hear me sing in many select choirs, on our church's worship team, and for many years as the first tenor in a gospel quartet. I would like to end my time today by playing a recording of my gospel quartet singing of Beulah Land that I also played during my dad's memorial. I mostly sang the high harmony parts in our quartet, but this was one of the few songs that I was the featured soloist and sang the melody. Thank you again for being here to celebrate the life of my incredible mom.
Beulah Land.
Has created a wonderful slideshow of visual memories as we continue to celebrate Carolyn's life. We'll share that now.
Say, I have no use for other sweets of any kind, baby, since the day you came around. From the start, I instantly made up my mind that you're the sweetest sweet that can be found.
You so sweet.
Oh, Pops.
Can't be beat.
You mean it?
Nothing sweeter ever stood on feet. Yes, every honeybee filled with jealousy when they see you out with me. I don't blame them, goodness knows. Honeysuckle rose, but
say, when you're passing by, flowers droop and sigh, and I know the reason why. You're much sweeter, goodness knows. Honeysuckle rose. Don't buy sugar.
You just have to touch my cup.
Say, you're my sugar.
It's sweet when you stir it up.
I'll be with you in apple blossom time. I'll be with you to change your name to mine. Say, happy the bride that the sun shines on today. What a wonderful wedding there will be. What a wonderful day. Chime, you will be mine.
Edelweiss, Edelweiss, every morning you greet me, small and white. Clean and bright, you look happy to meet me. Blossom of snow, may you bloom and grow, bloom and grow forever. Edelweiss, Edelweiss, bless my homeland forever.
tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever.
This time we have an opportunity for folks, I'm going to grab that microphone, to share if you have any memories or stories, brief words that you'd like to share of Thanksgiving for Carolyn. I would open it up to anybody who'd like to share. All right, got one right here. Make sure I'm on here. There we go. Okay. Hold it up. Good. There you are.
Is it on?
Yes, we're good.
Well, Carolyn and I were high school classmates, and then I had the privilege of serving on our reunion committee, and Carolyn headed that up, and she knew how to organize, and not only organize, but get it done, and we had wonderful class reunions all those years, and I just want to express my appreciation that I had the privilege knowing her and serving with her.
Great, thank you. Any others? Yes. There you go.
I know Carolyn and Chuck because I married Keith, who is their nephew, and Chuck and Carolyn opened their home to us so many times for family reunion and watching Dad and Chuck and the guys all play pinochle and the women caught up and we got to go to the mall together. One of my favorite memories was Chuck and Dad, I don't know anything about pinochle, but they got the highest score ever. Now, Grandpa, we had to help him into the room to play cards, and Chuck wasn't able to walk very good. But those two danced around the room that night, and I don't know who laughed harder, Grandma or Carolyn, about those guys, but they had so much fun, and I thank them so much for opening their home to us. It was wonderful times that we'll remember forever.
That's great. Anybody else? Ah, right here.
My name's Doug Lehrman. I'm in the presence here of about six or eight people in this room that have served as the finance chairperson at this church.
Yes.
In all those years, Carolyn served as the finance secretary. She always was spot on in her ability to predict how the pledge income would be, what individual families would give. She kept all of that information totally confidential, as is the nature of that role. She always gave spot on good information to the administrative board chairs and the finance chairs and all of us who worked in administrative positions here in this church. So much admiration and respect for her skills, and what a loving, wonderful person she was.
Thank you, Doug. That one here. I'll make it back there in a minute.
She told me once that she learned bookkeeping by counting the cash when she volunteered when she was a teenager here in this church.
Yes.
So that's her experience. I got the privilege of becoming the church historian about 10, 15 years ago. Anyway, after going through all those records back there, anytime I had a question about this history of this church, since she's third generation,
yes,
I went to Carolyn and she had it.
Great.
So we used to correspond back and forth. I'd ask her, I'd send her a letter and said, what about this? And I knew she finally lost it when she started sending that stuff back to me that I sent her.
Yeah. Aw. Thank you, Larry. We got Karen back here.
About 3 years ago, I think it was probably about the time she was getting ready to move up north, Richard and I were, there's a flower bed that runs parallel with the parking lot out here, and it was just totally weed infested. And I remember years ago when Joyce was the pastor here, that Joyce and I think Carol Peterson planted irises out there. And so Richard and I were like, that is such an eyesore. We made a pledge that we were going to clean it up that spring when it was, you know, this type of weather. So him and I are out there, and we're digging, and we're cleaning out all the weeds. And she comes out of the church, and she's almost indignant. What are you guys doing? Kind of question. And I was like, we're cleaning out the iris bed. And she goes, oh, you know those came from my garden. I did not know that. And so now when I look at those flowers, I remember those came from Carolyn's. And family members, if you don't have an iris start or two from her, I'm sure we won't miss one or two if they get dug up. They probably need to be thinned out again, and we have not weeded it this year. But for those of you that didn't know, when you drive by and those irises are blooming, they came from her garden. Joyce might be able to give more story about it, but that's all I know.
Oh, thank you. Got one behind us here. Yes.
Okay. Carolyn Officer asked me one Sunday to join the team that processes the finances of the church. 15 years later, here I am. She was so very devoted to her job here. The church was her community, and it's mine in so many ways also. Later, I moved to the same condo complex, and from time to time, I would walk down to her unit. We would chat, figure out complex issues, solve the problems of the world, and laugh a lot. We humans aren't very aware that every minute of every day is a gift, and growing old is a privilege, not a right. So rest on your laurels, Carolyn, unless God has an accounting department. I'm pretty sure he could use your talents.
Yes, and that could be happening right now. Do we have others? Yeah, oh, up over there, Joyce.
Joyce and Maria, I got to be one of Carolyn's pastors. And I would say amen to everything that has been shared. But because of the tragedy, Wayne, in her life, oftentimes I would go over and just sit in her presence and pray through difficult situations. Because of the profound faith that she had that could not be rocked by the troubles that we deal with as human beings. So I loved her financial acuity, her love of gardening, her love of history. She was a profound friend. But her ability to live in her faith is something I will always treasure, and her love for her family.
Yes. Do we have others? Anybody? Yes.
Just a very simple thing.
Close to you there. There you go.
When I moved from Battleground to Phillida, I had jillions of boxes. When Carolyn was moving, I got to unload a lot of them for her, and we filled up her car. I was delighted.
Oh, that's great. Are there others? Anybody else? Anybody in the family wanted to share any last remembering thoughts before we go on to the next thing? No, we all had some time to do that earlier, so we're good. Okay, all right. Well, thank you all so much. I know that probably every single person here has a story that you could share about Carolyn. And so I encourage you in the weeks and months ahead, as those thoughts come to you, drop a note to the family that you're thinking about Carolyn and you wanted to share this memory, because it will be a beautiful way to continue to celebrate her life by remembering and recalling those stories that are special to you and are memories for you. But right now, because as Joyce mentioned, her faith is so important in her story. I want to read a passage to you from John 14. Hear now these words of scripture for us today. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. Thanks be to God for the reading and hearing of these words of good news. As we gather here today and we celebrate, we're celebrating not only Carolyn's beautiful life of almost 93 years, but also we celebrate that by God's grace and through her faith, on April 3rd, 2024, Carolyn was born into a new life, a life that's eternal in glory with the communion of saints in the presence of her Lord. The Lord had prepared a place for her. And as I read these words from John 14 and think about her and her life, I can't help but imagine it must have had a very special, profound meaning for her to hear the Lord say, I will not leave you orphaned. I have prepared a place for you. I will always be with you. Peace be with you. Carolyn's faith and her love for her family, her friends, those were central themes in her life as we heard from all of the stories. And as a lifelong member of Salmon Creek United Methodist Church, she's registered in our cradle roll at her birth, as you will see over there in a few minutes. Third generation. This church, when I came, it was remarkable to me, the strength of history and tradition that this place holds, and how many people who are here have been here for generations, who have been here for their lifetime, who know the history of Pioneer Chapel when it was the only place to worship out here, not this space. So much love of history and one another. The stability of this church became her family, is my understanding. And her home away from home. And I know that that's that love that many of you feel for this place and for one another. This church, as Larry mentioned, he mentioned to me the other day that she learned her skills in accounting very early by counting our Sunday offering with our counting team as a teenager, learning about the importance of counting it right. She was counting it right for the Lord. It was a serious thing, and she got it right and fell in love with that. And she served and worshiped alongside of many of you who are here today, who loved serving with her. And I'm so grateful that you all were able to share some special memories of Carolyn and how that her life touched yours, how her grace and strength and faith had an impact on you, as it has on her closest family members. We know that you all feel like she's family as well in many ways. And so we know clearly that Carolyn is a woman who is deeply loved and will be deeply missed. And yet, even as our hearts feel her physical, the loss of her physical presence with us, we can trust by our faith that just as God's grace covered Carolyn's life, God's grace is sufficient to carry you through the season ahead of you as you're facing this time of loss in your family. You all know how to do that. She's taught you how to lean on God and lean on that grace that will carry you when there's that one set of footprints, as you were remembering for us. We know that Carolyn understood this, and we all trust that Carolyn has gone to the place that was prepared for her by her Lord Jesus. And we trust that the advocate described by Jesus in that gospel passage from John, the Holy Spirit, is with all of us even now as we continue through our earthly lives, leaning into the courage of our faith, trusting in God to guide us and be with us. There is nothing in our lives, nothing in Carolyn's life, that we face alone. Nothing, no struggle, no joy, no question, no challenge, no doubt, nothing that we face alone, because the Holy Spirit is in us as close as our very breath. God is with us through the days of our lives and beyond. I pray that as we go out from here today, that all of you will remember that Jesus taught you to trust in the power and presence of the Holy Spirit with you, that Carolyn left us that example of how to trust that God is always with us. And I pray that you will remember and give thanks for Carolyn's life today and in the days ahead, for all that she taught you as she navigated life with faith and strength and courage and grace and love. Our Lord has prepared a place for her and for us. May we all trust in these words of promise, these words of hope, as we live into the days ahead. Amen. At this time, I'd invite you to join your heart with mine as I share these words of prayer. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. We pray to you for one another in our need and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To all who have sinned, mercy. To all who sorrow, your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. And in all our ways, Lord, we trust you. And we offer to you with your church on earth and in heaven, honor and glory, Lord, now and forever. As we remember, O God, that all you have given us is already yours. As first you gave Carolyn to us, now we give her back to you. Receive Carolyn into the arms of your mercy. Raise Carolyn up with all your people. Receive us also and raise us into a new life. Help us so to love and serve you in this world that we may enter into your joy in the world to come. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Carolyn Officer. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive Carolyn into the arms of your mercy and into the blessed rest of everlasting peace with the glorious company of the saints of light. Amen. I would invite you to join your voice with mine as we share in this prayer our Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I would invite you to rise in body or spirit as we lift our voices in the song, How Great Thou Art.
And there will be my God.
benediction, I will lead the family across the hall where a reception has been prepared. I hope that you will come over and join in that time of fellowship, visit the table of memories that has been set up, and share, maybe enjoy one of those little Hershey's kisses that are scattered around the room, reminding us of Carolyn today. And so as we get prepared to leave this place, I offer you this blessing. I pray that you go from here confident in God's great love for you, that you are a child of God, and that you go confident and assured that you are redeemed, as we all are, fully at the foot of the cross, and that you will go filled with the comfort and guidance and inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that advocate who is always with us, working in us and through us. Go forth in that blessing, friends, and remember the joy and hope that we have in our faith. Amen.